Okay, this is the learning outcome for this topic, for today's topic. So by the end of this lesson, you should be able to, number one, explain the basic concept of measurement and its importance. Number two, describe and use SI units. Number three, identify and describe the elements of a measurement system. And number four, describe the categories of standards and its features. Okay, by the end of this class, you will have a short quiz that you need to answer in ULearn. And you also need to record your attendance in ULearn. So afterwards, I'll let you know. Why is this subject important? So because measurement is a part of our everyday life. Whatever we do, every activity that we do, we always involve some form of measurement. When we wake up in the morning, we are concerned about the time, whether we are early or we are late. When we go buy something, we are concerned about the price and the amount of thing that we get. For example, RM1 gets you a bungkus of nasi lemak. So how much nasi lemak is in there for RM1? So everything involves around some form of measurement. Since the context is very large, we are going to focus on the engineering context. When we want to do measurement, we are concerned about the accuracy and reliability of our measurement. And later on, we will see that this will depend on many factors. Three of the most common one is what instrument we are using. Okay, some of our classmates request to join. Okay, still pending. Right, let me settle the pending request first. Okay, Nordiana, there are no pending requests as I can see in my monitor now. Now there are already 50 members in my group. Okay, if there are any students who cannot access, then let me know. Yeah, there are no requests right now. Okay, coming back. So we are focused about accuracy and reliability of our measurement. So apart from the instrument, we are concerned about the method that we use to measure, whether the method is correct, and the reliability of the person doing the measuring. Right. Now, let's start with a thought experiment. Now, assume you are a chief railway engineer and you are involved in purchasing new trains for nationwide use. You are required to ensure that the trains must match your railway tracks and stations, the platforms where the station embarks or disembark, where people ride them or take off. Any miscalculation will cause serious implication to the country. So how do you ensure you do the measurement correctly? So this is actually in France. Around 2014. But let's say you are in this position. How do you make sure before you purchase the train, the train must match your railway track and they must match the station that the train is going to pass through? Right? So here I list a few sample answers. You may come up with your own answers. So if you are the chief railway engineer, first you must instruct your engineering team to refer to the technical drawing. Okay, find the technical drawing and determine what are the dimension for your tracks and for your station. What are the clearances? What are the distances? Okay, and then you need to verify the dimension and unit. Because usually train stations have already been built more than a few decades, maybe 50, 60 years ago. And maybe the unit and the measurement at that time is different. Right? And then also maybe there will be some differences between the technical drawing and the actual measurement. So after you verify with the technical drawing, you need to conduct extensive site measurement to make sure the drawing matches the actual construction. And then so you need to verify if there are any difference in train stations at different places. So if you look Google, you'll find about this story here for the French train operator. The company is has an abbreviation of SCNF. So they purchased 2,000 new trains, I think back in 2000, early 2010 maybe. Okay, they purchased 2,000 new trains at a cost of 15 billion euros, which is roughly equivalent to 70 billion RM. So they purchase it by stages lah. By stages, every few years, they are going to add new trains to replace all the trains. But after the purchasing has been secured, I mean, the deal agreement has been signed, the first delivery of the train comes, they found out that the new trains were too wide for many regional platforms. Terlalu lebar. So the reason for this error was because they provided platform measurement built less than 30 years ago. Whereas many of the stations platforms were built more than 50 years ago when the trains were much smaller. So now, apart from the 15 billion euros, they cannot cancel the agreement because they made the purchasing already. So now they have to add more money and modify the existing platforms so that the train can be used. So can you imagine? This is a great embarrassment for the train operator because this is they see this as like a stupid mistake or a childlike mistake. But we humans, this is common. No matter how smart we are always prone to making mistakes. So we always need to be careful and we need to always remind ourselves about this. And you can verify the story, the news source I've given there. So you can use the link to read more about the story. Coming back to our point, this is why you as manufacturing engineers and all engineers for that matter need to understand the basics of proper instrumentation. Now, if we look at the name of our subject, there are three keywords that we need to know. You don't need to memorize these terms. You just need to understand if you can come up with your own sentence to describe and it matches what it is, the definition is, it should be fine. Okay, dalam kelas saya, in my class, jangan hafal sepatah-sepatah. I don't like rote memorization. I want you to show your understanding. Right, so the first word is principle. So principle is a basic truth about something. So instrumentation, the second keyword, is the equipment that we use to measure, indicate and record physical quantities. Okay, so a simple example are rulers and weighing scale when we want to measure length and measure weight. And then the third keyword is measurement. So measurement is the act of measuring by assigning a number and a unit. Okay, I highlighted this one, number and unit, because it's very critical. I see that for even your seniors, fourth year student, sometimes when they write answers, they write the answer without giving the unit. So in engineering, writing a number without a unit is a major sin, dosa besar. Because without a unit, we do not know the context of your measurement. Okay, and I'll have another story that I will share with you afterwards regarding the number and unit. And the science of measurement, we call it as metrology. So measurement application can be classified into three major areas. Number one, when you want to measure physical quantities, this is the most common one. And when we want to measure something, we must refer it to a standard. Okay, why we need to refer to a standard? Because when other people are doing the similar measurement, by referring to the same standards, you ensure that you and the other person are measuring the same thing. Without a standard, then probably you and I are going to measure something and we find our values very different and we don't know how to make them, to compare them. Okay, that is number one. Number two is monitoring function. When you want to monitor a certain measurement. And number three is part of automatic feedback control system. So these are the major areas when we want to, or major purpose, why we want to do measurement. So these are sample application. Okay, let's say we want to measure the temperature. So if we simply want to measure temperature of physical materials, or if you want to measure our own body temperature, whether we want to verify we have a fever or not. So we use a thermometer and we get the temperature value. So that is application number one, when we measure the temperature. But we also measure temperature for the purpose of monitoring. For example, in airports, when we want to screen people who have fevers. So the picture shown in this slide is what we call as thermal imager, where any person passing through the camera, passing by the camera, their body temperature will be captured. And if they show high temperature, they are going to be separated from the group and they are going to be screened more detailed. Okay, so this is for area number two. We want to monitor the temperature. And then for number three, we want to use it as a feedback for our automated system. You refer to the figure below here. So you have a block diagram and you have the room temperature. So you have the room temperature here. You want to regulate the room temperature. So you have a temperature measuring device, and the measuring device construct or organize or provide value of the current temperature. So let's say now the room temperature is 20, but you want to raise it to 24 degrees Celsius. The room temperature is 20 degrees Celsius. You want to raise it to 24. So what the temperature measuring device is going to do is going to provide the temperature to the comparator. So the comparator will pass the information of the difference to the heater, and the heater will heat up the room until it reaches 24 degrees Celsius. So you can easily replace the heater with air conditioner as well. So let's say the room temperature is 30. You want to reduce the room temperature to 24. So the temperature measuring device will provide the temperature, let's say 30. So it's going to be minus with the room temperature 24, and the air conditioner here will reduce the temperature until it reaches our desired temperature. So this is for application number three, when we want it as part of an automatic feedback system. Okay. I just added two more, Muhammad Amirul Ali and Amirul Anwar in the group. Okay, moving on. So for measurement units, we are going to use the International System of Units, which is SI. You are already familiar with this. For base units, there are seven units, which forms the basis of SI units. And it is going to be the basis of other units where we can derive according to the application. So I hope you can memorize these seven base units. So we have kilogram, this is for weight, meter for length, second for time, ampere for electrical current, Kelvin for temperature, mole for chemical amount of substance, and candela for light intensity. Okay, from these seven, these are the defining constants that they use to develop the unit, and these are the actual value given for each defining constant. Now, I'm not going to discuss in detail how from this value they get this value, because that involves another different story. We are just going to apply it. If from those base units, we can produce derived unit. Okay, a derived unit is recognized by the dimension, and it's actually a combination with base units or with other derived units. So these are three simple examples. If you want to find the area, so area is actually the length times the length So this is two base, these are two base units. So you get the dimension as meter square. Velocity, we have the length divide by time. So length is a base unit. Time is a different base unit. So we get the unit as meter per second. And acceleration, we have velocity divide by time. So velocity is a derived unit. Time is a base unit. And we combine them together, the unit is given as meter per second squared. Okay, so derived unit can be either combination with its own base unit, a base unit with another base unit, or base unit with another derived unit. Dimension equation can help to convert from one system of units to another, derived equation for physical quantities, and check equation accuracy. These are sample derived units that I got from Wikipedia. There are many listed. A complete list is already available in Wikipedia, so you can go there and check. I provided the link. So these are sample examples of derived units that is given a special name. For example, if you look at the top one, frequency, the actual unit is 1/s. But the scientific community decided to honor a scientist by the name of Hertz for the unit of frequency. So now we call frequency in the unit of Hertz. So actually, the SI unit is 1/s. And similar with, for example, Newton. So Newton is a unit of force. The actual SI unit or dimension is kilogram meter per second squared. But we usually say it in the unit of newtons instead of this SI unit because it's more easier for us to relay our information. Right? So these are sample example. It's actually a long list. I'm just cut and paste a short portion of the table. Okay, these are examples of mechanical SI units related to your field. Okay, also a long list. I just screen cap the top one and you can refer the detailed list in the Wikipedia website and together with all the base units and the quantity it represents. Okay, apart from the SI units, we also have what we call as prefixes. Now, prefixes when we use when we want to measure something and the value is either very big or very small. The most common type of measurement that we see each day that uses prefixes is when we talk about data storage, your pen drive, your hard disk, your cloud storage. The most common pen drive that we use now is maybe the memory card is around 64 gig or maybe 32 gig. So we use 32 gigabyte, for example, to represent the value. If you want to write it in numbers, it's going to be very, very annoying because if you want to write the whole value, it's going to be like 32 gigabyte. That means 32 with 9 zeros at the back. So our writing will be quite long. So to make matters easier, instead of writing 32 gigabyte as 32 with 9 zeros at the back, we just replace it with a symbol 32 GB. Much more convenient. Okay, sometimes we don't use the symbol, we use the numbers like 10 to the power of 9, especially when we do our calculation. Okay, because sometimes we want to cancel out the value, we do it in a numbers form so that easier for us to cancel out the values. Okay, so these are what we call as prefixes. So a number when you measure can also be very small, like the size of an atom or the size of an electron. So now, instead of having a value with so many zeros at the back, you have values with zeros at the front. So now we are talking about nanotechnology. So when we talk about nanotechnology, actually we are talking about a measurement that has after the decimal point, we have 0, 8 zeros at the front. of the value. So very, very small our measurement capability. Okay, so you need to be proficient in using the values here. And we will do the exercises once we reach at that point in our upcoming weeks. Okay, apart from SI unit, we also have imperial units. So imperial units is an old British system for measuring units. So instead of using centimeter, meter and kilometer, they use inch, foot, mile and so on. And for area, they use square feet, 1 acre. In our practice in Malaysia, there are still some field that use imperial units. For example, if you want to buy a house, usually the area of the land or the area of the house is given in imperial units, a few feet, like 20 kaki kali 70 kaki, 20 feet times 70 feet. They don't provide in meters because people seem to be used to using feet. They haven't migrated. If you want to buy construction materials like tiles, right, for your house, many still use the imperial units. And there are still a few applications. Like if you want to buy land, some still use acre. Berapa ekar tanah tu? Because in the grant dekat Jabatan Tanah tu, at the land department, usually it's measured in acres, the old grants. So still some, but not too many. Right? But imperial units have many weaknesses. It has inconsistent scale, arbitrary range, and confusing unit conversion. So like if you want to measure length, right? As you can see in the figure here, if you use SI, from millimeter to meter, so we have 1 meter is equivalent to 1,000 millimeters. And 1 kilometer is equivalent to 1,000 meters. And 1 kilogram is equal to 1,000 grams, and so on. So you have a consistent range, which makes it easier for you to convert from one unit to another. But for imperial units, the range is arbitrary. You see, in 1 feet, 1 foot, you have 12 inches. In a yard, you have 3 feet. In a mile, you have 1,760 yards. So there's no consistent range, which makes easy for you to do mistake. Similar for temperature, we use Celsius. So Celsius, the range is intuitive, 0 to 100. So 50, we know, is the middle point, 100 is the boiling point. But for if we use Fahrenheit, it doesn't start at 0, it starts at 32. So actually 32 is the freezing point in Fahrenheit. And the range is 180, not 100. So when we read a value, like for example, 80 Fahrenheit, what does it mean? We don't know because we are not sure. Okay, this is the weakness of the imperial units. And similarly, countries like United States, when they write their dates, they write month first, then day, then year. For us here in Malaysia, we use day, then month, then year. So sometimes there might be confusion when you use the computer setting is in US, so you might get confused about the date. Okay. So in the world, as of 2019, there are only 3 countries that still uses imperial units. Okay, so in this map, it is highlighted in red. Do you know which country this is? So this is United States, Liberia, a small African country, and Myanmar, our Southeast Asian neighbor. And then the yellow one here is UK, United Kingdom, the origin of British imperial unit. So even they use imperial, some of them they use imperial, but mainly they use metric. They use a combination of imperial and metric. So for the rest of the world, including us Malaysia, we use metric as our main measurement unit. Okay, so when we talk about conversion between metric and imperial unit, this is a very interesting story. So this happened back in 1999, which is about 21 years ago, when NASA launched an orbiter to study the weather at Mars, planet Mars. So this is the orbiter. So they want to study the weather to see whether there are any possible life or aliens that exist in Mars. Okay, so they submit or they launch this orbiter. And here on the left hand side, you see the solar panel. So the solar panel is used to power up the orbiter. And then inside the orbiter, they have thrusters that determine the trajectory, the direction of the orbiter. So the trajectory of the orbiter needs to be corrected from time to time to make sure that it is on course. But there is a problem at that time that they did not notice. So NASA appointed Lockheed Martin as a contractor to fabricate the orbiter. So NASA assumed standard SI units were used, but actually Lockheed Martin used imperial units. So when they want to, every time they want to correct the direction of the orbiter, they put into the computer software the wrong value. Okay, so when Lockheed Martin provide one the value of one, NASA assume the value is 1 newton per second, but actually it's 1 pound force second. So there is a difference of factor by 4.445. And this was the main reason why when the orbiter approached the atmosphere of the planet Mars, it got destroyed. And the cost for the orbiter, the loss is around $200 million at the time. Okay, simply because they did not verify the unit of conversion. So which is why I want to highlight, when we do measurement, each measurement must have a number and a unit. Okay, and if you want to find out more about the story, you can check the link, YouTube link here, and watch for yourself. Okay, so now it's 11:40. Let's take a short 5-minute break before I cover into the next items, which are the elements of a measurement system and the categories of standards. Okay, so now it's 11:40. I have a short 5-minute break. We continue at 11:45. Meanwhile, if you have any questions, you can write up in the meeting chat and I'll try to respond.